very good evening to you, beloveds. A very good evening to you. I believe that today the Lord has graced us with better preparation for the service. A very good evening to you. Kindly log in, share with a friend. I believe that many people who have not seen the notification that yesterday's broadcast is being done today. So kindly share with someone that we're online so that they may be able to hear the word of the Lord for themselves in this very day. Do share with us where you are joining us from while we wait for others to log in. A very good evening to you. I do pray and hope that you had a wonderful, blessed Sunday and that you've been using it to commune with the Lord, to hear the voice of the Lord and what He's doing in this very day. So invite someone to come and hear the word of the Lord for themselves. Another thing that I want to check before we get to the word, I do trust that today we won't have any interruptions. I need you to indicate if you can hear me properly. If you can hear me properly. We're going to be touching on very sensitive issues. So I need you to also be praying for your heart, to be praying for your heart, to be praying for your spirit, that you may be able to hear the Spirit of the Lord and you may be able to hear truth. You may be able to hear truth, 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 truth. That is the one thing that we need more than anything else in this world, especially in the time that we're in. So if you guys can hear me properly, I need you to indicate that so that I know that I am audible to all of you. I'm playing instrumental in the background. So I need to know that it is not disturbing or it is not overpowering my voice, that you can hear me clearly. If you can hear me clearly, that is wonderful. Properly. Okay, majority of you can hear me. All right. How wonderful. We are all clear. All right. So yesterday, before we were cut off, I honestly believe that as much as some things are happen not according to what we have planned, but I do believe that the Lord wanted you to really ponder on that word that I gave you yesterday concerning pruning. Concerning pruning. All right. Majority of you can hear me properly. That's wonderful. That is wonderful. I guess now we can proceed to the word that the Lord has in store for us. Anytime you see interruptions, this is not the first time this is happening, interruptions of any sort, of course, some things can be better planned for, some things can be better done. From our side, we're really doing our best to give you the word of the Lord in utmost excellence. But sometimes we are short of resources, and we do the best with what we have at the moment. So you have to bear with us in that regard. We are doing the best that we can with everything that we have. And, you know, like the Bible says, If you can be faithful with the little, then God can trust you with the much. So some of the things that we go through in life, because sometimes people think as ministers you're exempted from certain challenges in life. We're not. In fact, we are the people that experience the most. Because for you to teach about something and for you to preach about something, you have to live it. So it really, really matters how you handle challenges and how you handle certain seasons in life and certain things that may happen, that may pose as a threat to that which the Lord is doing through you. And your attitude and your perception over everything that happens in your life is very important, because anytime there is a challenge, anytime there's a hiccup, anytime there's a glitch to the flow of things, know that it is a time of promotion in your life. So the one thing that we teach and the one thing we try to live by ourselves is the understanding that there is no such thing as bad luck or bad omens or any of those things. There's the perception that we have as per given by the living God, which is the perception of victory. So in any situation that you face, you have to look at the victory that you stand to gain. You look at it from a victory stand of point to say that no matter what I see happening on ground right now, my eyes are fixed on what Jesus has shown me as my end. And when you have that kind of perception, God will help you to maneuver your way through any season of your life. That is something that we need to learn as children of God. And that is how we keep the enemy out of our minds and out of our lives, by being able to perceive God in all situations, even when the enemy is acting or the enemy is trying to do something in your life. You need to fix your eyes on Jesus. You need to fix your eyes on Jesus to say, Lord, what are you doing through this situation? What are you doing in my life through this season that I am going through in my life? It's very, very important to look at things from the perception of the Lord. So before we got cut off the other day, we spoke about pruning. I'm not going to go back to it. I believe that I made it as clear as possible for us to understand what the Lord is saying concerning the season that we are in and the fruitfulness that He wants to bring into our lives through the pruning. I also touched on the first prophetic word that the Lord gave us, which concerned boarding schools. The Lord did say that He's going to be dealing with boarding schools. He said, boarding schools, I close boarding schools. I close boarding schools. This was given on the 27th of this month. The Lord said, too much wickedness is happening in boarding schools. So for those of you that know certain individuals that are in boarding schools, those of you that have your children in boarding schools, this word is for you. And you need to take this word before the Lord and ask Him to give you the right words to pray concerning your children or concerning your siblings or concerning whoever that may be related to you that is in boarding schools. So the Lord said He's going to be dealing with that as He is dealing with everything else in this very time concerning wickedness. Now, I just want to touch on something briefly before we go on. There's so many prophetic words that the Lord has given through this ministry that sometimes I feel like we gloss over certain things because there's just too much prophetic word that has been given by the Lord in this season in a very short span of time. So sometimes it's very easy to miss the word as it comes to pass. There was a time the Lord said, a clash of the titans. Zalipa isalia terika subelia bariata. He said, we have come into a time of a clash of titans. Now, when we talk about titans, we're talking about giants. We're talking about individuals that are at the very top of the mountains of life. We're talking about influencers, global influencers. And then he also used another ideology. He said, bulls in the season lock horns. As the bulls lock horns, I, the Lord, will cause them to yank each other's horns off by reason of them being locked. And that word is in relation with the word he gave concerning titans, to say that we are about to see a clash of the titans. Now, what we're seeing transpiring on the global stage right about now, including in this very nation, and which is about to get very much more evident, is that you'll begin to see certain individuals that used to be in the same camp, that used to have the same agenda, the same mandate, now fighting one another. And what is going to be happening in this time is that they are going to begin to tell on one another. Why? Because there is no loyalty in Satan's camp. There is no loyalty in Satan's camp. Why is there no loyalty in Satan's camp? It's very simple. Where there is no truth, there is no loyalty. Where there is no truth, there is no loyalty. They've been around one another. They've seen what the other can do to other people. So we're in a time where now paranoia also has crept into the enemy's camp. And now the level of mistrust is at its peak. The level of paranoia is at its peak. Like the Bible says, like I said, the time where I spoke about being translated back in time, and I found Isaiah ministering to certain individuals, and he said, there is nothing new under the sun. None of these things are new. We've seen it happen every time God gives his people victory. We have seen this happening where he causes confusion in the enemy's camp. That is why the Lord said, the victory is mine. That is why the Lord said, I, the Lord, will vindicate you. You don't have to fight for yourself. We have seen the injustice that has been taking place globally for many, many years, even in your own personal life. You know that the level of injustice that has taken place in your own life. And God said, we have now entered that time. Because like in the time of Gideon, God was still sieving in his own camp for those that he's going to use as the forerunners, for those that he's going to use to fight for the rest of his camp, for the rest of the church. And we've seen the shakings that have been taking place. What were those shakings doing in our camp? Those shakings were now seething between those with faith and those without faith in the spoken word of the Lord. By reason of us seeing the opposite of what was prophesied or what was declared by the Lord, that was a test of seething. I'm going to say that again. Everything that you have been seeing transpiring in this time was meant to sieve, was meant to show you whether you are part of the 300 or whether you are part of those that went back or those that were sent back to the camp that could not be taken in to the battlefield. Because God needed those. He wasn't necessarily looking for the best fighters. He was looking for those with faith. Because once you get to the battlefield, you realize it is the level of following instructions that gives you the victory. It is the level of your faith that gives you victory. It is not how well you can fight, because you don't even have to fight. You will realize that God doesn't even require for you to fight when you get to the battlefield. So that is why he doesn't want you to panic when you see the chariots, when you see the number of soldiers they have, when you see their ammunition, when you see everything they have, the resources they have that you don't have, God says, don't panic. Victory is mine. Victory is yours. But what I do need from you is your ability to follow every instruction I give you. No matter how ridiculous that instruction may sound, beloved, that is why in this season, everything, almost on a daily basis, the one thing that the Holy Spirit keeps drumming into our spirit man is obedience. 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 It is the most crucial thing for any believer. Throughout the Bible, those that were counted as mighty men, those that were counted in history, biblically, were men and women of obedience. They followed every instruction the Lord gave, no matter how ridiculous that instruction looked, no matter how that instruction didn't even look like it had anything to do with the current matter or with the current situation they found themselves in. Why? Because the ways of God are not the ways of men. So what makes us stumble at the ways of God? We are looking for God to be rational. We are looking for God to be logical. We are looking for God to align with our thoughts. We are looking for God to align with our mindset. We are looking for God to align with the systems of this world. But he says, my ways are not your ways. Neither are my thoughts your thoughts. I don't do it the way that you do. Because if I was to do it the way that you do, then you would definitely fail. You would definitely fail. And the enemy would definitely have victory over you. Why? Because your ways are familiar to him. Your ways are known by the enemy. Your ways are easily calculated by the enemy. So if I was to use your ways, I lower myself to the standard of Satan, and I'm not about to do that as God. So for me to give you the victory, I have to take you into a place that even you are unfamiliar with. Why? Because if I was to show you the fullness of the journey, the fullness of what I'm about to do with you, you would tell and the enemy would know. And God is not about to do that. He knows you. He knows you can't hold it in. Rabu wa rabalabala. We are human. Satan doesn't need you to post it on social media. He just needs you to whisper to your friend that you trust so much. Just one person. He just needs you to speak it and it's done. He knows. What does he work with? Familiar spirits. What does familiar mean? They look for familiarity. They look for things that are familiar. They look for things that are in line with the pattern of how you do life. They study you. They study how you think. They study how you react to certain things. And then they use that against you to win you over. They use that against you to take you out. And God says, if I'm to give you victory, I have to take you in blind. I have to omit certain things from you and only give you instructions on what to do. What you are supposed to do is to trust me. You see, when you trust, you don't have to know the fullness of the story. When you trust, you just follow because you trust. You trust the outcome of the one that you are following. You trust that they would never instruct you to do anything that would cost you. You trust that whatever that they're instructing you to do is what is best for you. Trust doesn't require to know all things. Trust. Trust. Do we trust him? Do we trust this God? How go to so and so's house and just help them today, just help them clean. It sounds insensitive. It sounds like God is not putting into consideration your situation. When are you going to move into her new house? You see, the heart we carry. Lord, I'm talking about me. You are talking to me about my lebogo, but I'm talking to you about me. And you're talking to me about somebody else. But he just gave you an answer to your problem. Because you don't know what is going to transpire in that place. Sometimes he's not even going to bless you through Malebogo. It's on your way back. There's an appointed place with a certain individual on your way back. He knows how long you're going to spend at Malebogo's place. And on the other side, he's working out your answer. With someone he did not mention in the instruction he gave you. The ways of God are not the ways of man. And that certain individual, he keeps them jammed up in traffic to make sure that they arrive where they're supposed to be at the very time where you are leaving Malebogo's house. And the Lord gives them an instruction. Bless this woman with 500 bula. Bless this woman with 1,000. Bless this woman with this. Bless her with that. Ask her if she needs a job. Beloveds, God answers us through the instructions he gives us. You want to know why we are stuck as humanity? We are simply stuck because we have a whole bunch of believers that are not true believers. Why are they not true believers? They have a pile of instructions they've been given by God that they have not followed. And that instruction that you have not followed is an answer someone is crying for to God. But God has already answered them through you, but you are refusing to answer. You are refusing to follow the instruction you were given by God. God is spirit. He's spirit. He's not going to come down and do what we are supposed to do. God works through men and women who are submitted to him. That's how we see him. That's why he said, "You carry my image." You are supposed to carry my image. Why did Adam and Eve fall? Why did they lose the image of God? What was that image? That image was obedience. As they obeyed God, God was proven faithful to those and to everything on planet Earth and creation by reason of everything that he is speaking in heaven being done on earth by those that he has made and those that he has commanded and instructed to reflect him. To say that I have spoken 1, 2, 3 in the heavenlies concerning earth, because I trust my children to follow through in that which I spoke, so that my word may be seen on planet earth as it is in heaven. So if it is written in heaven that grace is supposed to do 1, 2, 3, 4 for Amos, but grace sits on the instruction that she's been given concerning Amos, she's not reflecting God. She's reflecting Satan. Because Satan is the father of disobedience. And our Father in heaven is the father of obedience. Who do we reflect? Who are we reflecting? Ask yourself that question. And your answer always lies in your path of obedience. I'll repeat that again. Everything you are looking for is in your path of obedience. And in the season that we're in, God has released angels that have come to qualify us for that which God is doing in this season through the testings that we're going to see. They come in the form of humans. They come in the form of humans. Even as we speak right now, majority of you, you have already met with angels. And I pray for you that you have done the right thing. They come in the form of humans. Bangwe ba tlhagela ele motho o tlhoka kana go ngwa le bega a jile ma blara kana le bega o ka re ontjo o ntse a go ga snafe kana a tshwere painte o ka re o go ga dlu a go ga dlu o ka re wa e go ga yana a ngwe le paintela sena sepe mo teng, but perception. What do you say? Hey baba la pisa ba a ke ra riang baba la pisa ba ithele motho a taba a go kopa madi a batla go a go ga di dilutsa gago. But deep down you know you are using that as an excuse to hold on to what you have because you feel times are hard and you need to hold on to what you have. You are hiding behind the sniffing of glue to not be a help to your brother or to your sister. Because if that was the case, you would invite them to go with you to the shop if they are saying they're hungry and actually buy the food for them to ensure that they don't go and buy glue. They come to test our wisdom. Are we in sync? Are we one with Holy Spirit? Because you don't even have to crack your brain. Holy Spirit will instruct you on what to do concerning the matter. The question is, do you listen to Holy Spirit when He speaks? Do you listen? Or do you tell yourself what will help your conscience for refusing to help? Because you live in a world where people are with hell, and you are looking out for yourself. And yet you say you trust Him. In many, many occasions, now I'm trying to show you. For years, I've gotten used to it. For years. I know. It's not my money. Everything I have, not just money, everything I have, it's not mine. We don't own anything in this world. We don't own anything. Then with whatever you have left, o tla bona gore wena we tshota ka engleng se nna ke tla go bontsha gore nya mme mo wa go tlhoka gonana mo wa go tlhoka gonana mo wa go tlhoka gonana. The question is, do you trust Him when He tells you, I know what you need for now, so don't worry about the other things you thought you needed. Don't worry about them. I know what you need now, and I know that you need this seed that you are sowing. Because if you spend all of this in that which you want to spend on, you are spending your seed as well. And I'm helping you by helping them. I'm helping you. Sow your seed. And 99.999% of the time, it doesn't matter who it is, whether they believe in God or not. Every time when I give as per instructed by the Lord, the first thing that person does or say is to release a blessing and to say thank you to the living God. Why? Because the spirit man can attest to the fact that it is God that is giving to them. It is not man. And because it is God giving back, giving to them, you just sown a seed that has been registered in heaven. And that seed will definitely, definitely germinate and produce fruit on your behalf. The question is, do we trust him? Do we trust him? We live in a place, in a realm of seed time and harvest time. That is the realm that we live in. Seed time and harvest time. That is what God set in motion. There is no other. I want to help somebody today. There's no other. That is exactly how it is. So if you are only a consumer, but you don't sow seed into the soil, as per instructed by Holy Spirit. Because remember, there are many places to sow your seed. Some places are thorny. It will not sprout. Sometimes it's by the wayside. So you have to be listening to Holy Spirit also on where to give. I remember there was a time we were taken on a mission outside this country. It was a very, very sensitive mission. Very sensitive. Very, very sensitive mission. And every single instruction counted from the Lord. We were going via South Africa, but we were not going to South Africa. And I remember the Lord telling me, because he knows every time I go to South Africa, I'm always moved to give. Because there's a lot of poverty in South Africa, especially in those areas where I would go. I would see a lot of people, you know, sleeping on the streets, a lot of beggars on the streets, sometimes with children. So I'm always moved to give every time when I'm on those trips. And God knew how I normally do things when I'm there. So he made it very clear. He said, because he knew what Satan was planning. And he said to me, do not give money. Do not give money on your way to that place via South Africa. When you get there, because we had to spend a night there and then leave the following day to our destination. He said, do not, no matter how desperate they may look, money don't. Food you can give, but money don't. Make any financial transactions while you are on your way to that place. And he made me understand that some would be agents of Satan masquerading themselves as beggars. That is why in the Lord there is balance. You see, I went to the other extreme. Now I'm coming back on the other side to bring you to a place of balance and to show you the need for Holy Spirit, even in your giving, to make sure that you sow on good ground everywhere you put your money. He said, make sure that you don't do that, because if you exchange, sometimes you are exchanging your light for darkness. Sometimes you are exchanging your health for sickness. But God is not calling us to a place of panic and paranoia where we shut it down and we don't give, we don't do anything. He says, follow my spirit. Follow the leading of my spirit. How do I like to go to the Nela Musadi Mughul? Nela Musadi Mughul Mati Muneli. Can I go to the Kiola Muneli? Can I go to your neighbor and buy them combo? Obo by Nela. Don't ask for a Mahura thing, Ganahona Ling, Ganahona. Just buy it, and I am the one who knows what they don't have as God. So I don't even want you to take, start taking credit for it. Just follow me. If I tell you to give them money, give them money. If I tell you to give them stuff, give them stuff. Just give what I tell you to give, because these are seeds. God can tell you to sow your clothes. He can tell you to sow your furniture. He can tell you. It's not just about money. It's about what that seed is supposed to produce in your life. You may be praying for certain things and God is saying, now you know what I want to put into your life, but now you are left with now sowing the seed. It's like wanting oranges in your yard. Until you plant. You, no matter how much you pray, you will not see those orange trees in your yard. Some of these things are practical, beloveds. Once you know what God wants to do in your life, you need to go back to the same God and ask him, what seed do I sow for this that I want, that you have shown me that you want to do in my life? It's something very practical that we understand also as ministers, and we do as well. No one is exempted from giving. No one. Every individual in this world, if you want to see mobility, if you want to see progress, you put seed on the ground. We see that even with our everyday life, when it comes to plants, if you want food, if the whole world was to stop agriculture, there is no food. There's a part we play. There's God's part, there's our part. God tells us the what and the where and the how. And we do our part. The woman who was in debt, she didn't think she had anything that she could possibly use. God showed her, you do. Don't look for a loan. I'm not going to make it rain from heaven. I'm going to give you a strategy on how to get out of debt. And the Lord said, use my eyes to see the treasure you have in your home that you don't know, that is treasure. It was a seed. What does a seed do? A seed is very small, but when you plant it where you are supposed to plant it, it grows into a big tree and then it starts giving you fruit. From that very small thing, you get something that is way bigger than you, that you can climb, that you can sit under, that you can eat from, that your animals can eat from a seed. A very small seed. That is what happens. And God says some of the things you despise that you have, those are seeds that can grow into big things, that can grow into the very things I've promised you. But you despise them because you don't think anything can come out of them. But I'm going to show you where to put it and what to do with them, and watch what happens. And how do you water your seed? You water your seed in prayer and supplication so that God can continue to show you what he's going to be doing. Some of you are saying, no audio. Kalim kutulo tekana, is it a technical problem on that side? Are you able to hear me, beloveds? Am I audible? Okay. My sister, I believe that there might be something wrong with your device, because the rest are saying they can hear me. So, beloveds, I'm going to be moving on to the prophetic word that the Lord has given us today. And then we are going to be touching on marriage. I believe this one is going to be a series, because I don't think we're going to be able to finish everything the Lord has been highlighting to me concerning marriage. like I said, we're going to be touching on very, very sensitive stuff. But things that we face on a daily basis. Amen. So I'm just going to pray over this word, and I'm going to go straight into it. Heavenly Father, I thank you. I thank you. I thank you. I thank you for your faithfulness in this time. I thank you for your unfailing love. As you continue to show us that love by giving us your word in this time, and your word in abundance, your word that is meant to instruct us, your word that is meant to give us direction, your word that is meant to lead us into life eternal. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for your word. For there is nothing that you have esteemed higher than your word. You have even esteemed it above yourself. That is how valuable your word is. We thank you, O King of Kings, in this very time, for the word that you continue to give us that helps us to grow in you, that helps us to grow in the knowledge of who you truly are. We thank you for simplifying that which would otherwise be hard to comprehend. We thank you, O King of Kings, for coming to our level, for lowering yourself and coming down to the level of your children to give us understanding of your majesty, to give us understanding of your glory, to give us understanding of who you are, and to give us understanding of who we are in you. May we continue to know you. May it be evident even in our lives, O King of Kings. May we experience change, tangible change in our perception, in our lives, in our physical appearance, in our surroundings, in everything that we engage with in our lives, O Lord. May it be evident that life has come. May it be evident that we are now anchored, we are now knitted as one with life, for you are indeed life. We thank you, O King of Kings, for helping us to erase every lie the enemy had put in us that was meant to register hopelessness and death in our spirit man. And we embrace life and everything that comes with it. We thank you and we bless you, O King of Kings. Holy Spirit, have your way with me. Have your way with the people of God. Ensure that we are synchronized in the understanding of the word that God is giving us in this very day. Even in difficult situations, Lord, help us to see your solution. Help us to see your answers. Help us to see your strategies. Help us to see the solutions that you have for our lives, even in impossible situations. For there is nothing impossible for you. For you alone are the true and living God. And to you we look for direction. We look for answers. We look for hope. We look for life. We bless you. We love you. We praise you. We worship you. In Jesus' mighty name, may it all be done by your spirit and through your spirit of truth. Amen and amen. On the 27th of this month, the word of the Lord continues. And he said to me, release favor. This was an instruction he gave me. He said, release favor. Favor upon your children. Favor. Favor. Release favor upon them where it matters. Now, so far I have, biologically I have one child. I have a son. So when the Lord said, release favor upon your children, I understood that he was talking to me in my spiritual place or my spiritual position as a mother to those that he has called me to mother in a spiritual understanding or in the spiritual things of life. He said, release favor upon them where it matters. And when I was getting this word from the Lord, I understood that. And I understood why on Monday he gave the word that he gave concerning an understanding of your assignment before you look for the resources. To say you need to understand, you need to understand what you have been assigned to do before you can receive the resources for that assignment, so that you may be a good steward of that which the Lord is about to entrust you with in this season. And the Lord said he is in this time releasing favor upon your life where it matters. Now it is very important to understand that part, because the Lord is not going to be releasing it haphazardly, or he's not going to be scattering his seed of favor. He says where it matters. And where does it matter? Where you are assigned in this season. God says start to engage your spiritual eyes. Start to engage your eyes of understanding, that you may see what area of your life is being favored by the Lord in this season. Because that is the part, or that is the area of your life where God is moving. And so that is where he wants you to expend your energies. Where he is found in your life in this season is going to be marked by the favor that is going to be coming upon that particular area in your life. So in this very time, by reason of the authority invested upon my life by Christ Jesus, our Lord and Savior, I therefore release upon your life favor of the Lord in the very area of your life in this season where the Lord is working. May you see his favor. May you experience the favor of the Lord in that area. And I pray for you in this very day that your eyes of understanding may be enlightened, that you may know and you may be able to perceive where God is moving in your life in this season, and be found in that place. For it is in that very place where you will experience the favor of the Lord. I pray that according to your own understanding, according to the workings of your knowledge, God may help you to perceive his move, to perceive him and where he is working in your life in this very time. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. The word of the Lord continues. He says, trees, engage trees. Engage trees. Everything that we engage with, including money, prosperity is directly aligned and linked to trees. Preservation is directly linked to trees. Everything concerning life is directly linked to trees. The Lord says, engage trees. God is going to be giving some of you dreams about certain trees, certain plants. And those dreams, may that, as an act of obedience or as an act of faith, I want you to purchase those trees and plant them in your yard. Put them in pots or whatever the case may be. If you don't have a lot of space, put them in pots. That will be an act of faith on your behalf. And God will begin to minister to you concerning those very trees that he has instructed you to get, because they're supposed to also help you to understand your assignment, to help you to understand your character as per given by God. Because every different tree has a different character to it. And God wants you to be able to know and understand who you are by the type of tree that he shows you. I've said this and I've touched on this before, to say that trees are different, even in terms of that the time it takes for them to germinate, the time it takes for them to grow, the time it takes for them to be fruitful, how they do in different seasons. Some trees better survive harsh conditions than others. Some trees survive in desert places than others. Some trees survive in sunny areas than others. You need to understand what type of a tree you are, that you may better understand the personality and the journey and the faith that is required for your journey by reason of the type of tree you are. I believe that I stand to be corrected. Trees like a bamboo tree takes 5 years to start growing. I don't know whether to start growing or to start to germinate, to sprout out of the soil. It takes 5 years. I don't know whether it's germinating or just growing, but I know that it's a tree that takes a long time to start to grow. But once it starts growing, it just starts shooting like nobody's business, to make up for all the years it took for it to start germinating. So some of you are like that. God can take some time working on you, preparing you for your assignment. Some people may look like they are far, that you started with, that they are far in life, they have succeeded in a lot of things, they have progressed in a lot of things, and you look stuck. Could it be that you are a different tree and you are comparing yourself to other trees that are of a different makeup than you? That is why it is very, very important to allow Holy Spirit to introduce you to you. To allow Holy Spirit to show you your own lane and what it looks like. So that you don't start looking at other people's lanes, or you don't start looking at other trees as they start blooming, they start producing fruit, and you are still in a baby stage and you're asking yourself, but we were put in the ground at the same time. What is wrong with me? There's nothing wrong with you. You are just a different tree. You are a different tree. You look at a cypress. I love them. I love them. You look at a cypress. It takes a long time to grow. It takes a while. You have to be very patient when you grow trees like that. Evergreens. I love them so much. But they take time. They're majestic in nature. You already conclude they are wealthy. It's because anything associated with God, it's majestic in nature, it's beautiful. You look at trees like a palm. It takes a while for a palm to grow, but you know, almost everyone in the world loves and appreciates palm trees. And when you look at how they are upright. Because we are called to an upright living. We are called to move, to grow upwardly. Risa bend, risa ring. That's why those that grow wild, God prunes them. So that they have a definite shape. They have a definite shape. You need to know, which tree are you? Investigate about that tree. Learn about it. Find out its characteristics. Find out even its healing properties. Find out everything you can, even concerning its fruit. When you look at a palm tree, for example, when you look at its fruit, dates are extremely nutritious. I believe they have like 9. I found it mind-blowing when I researched about them last year. They have like 9 nutrients, if I'm not mistaken. And then the Holy Spirit said, how many principles are there in the fruit of the Spirit? The characteristics of the fruit of the Spirit, which are what? The nutrients of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. There are 9. So that 9 marks completion of a fruit. Completion of the nutrients of a fruit. And dates have the completion of all the nutrients needed from a fruit. But it took a while. Or it takes a while for a palm tree to grow. That's why some people buy them, and they just bring them like that and establish them in their homes or at their resorts. Because they take a while to grow. You look at a cypress. It's upright and it's pointy. It's pointing upward. Why? Because we are looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. And it is perpetually green. It is evergreen. That's why the group are called evergreens. Because from January to December, they're green. Even in places where they have snow, they remain green. In places where it gets extremely hot, they still remain green. Why? Because the makeup of their leaves is in such a way that they retain their water. They don't easily lose their water. They're evergreen. What are we called to be? We are called to thrive in all situations. We are called to thrive even in situations where it is dry in the world. Why? Because we are evergreens. And we are ever looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Beloveds, you need to understand something. Everything that has been made, it's meant to point us to Jesus. Everything is in its symbolism and in what it communicates. It's meant to point us to Jesus. That is why the Bible says everything that was made, there's nothing that was made outside him. But all things that are, all things that have been made are made in him and of him. So if they are made in him and of him, they have to point us to him one way or another. They have to point us to him. And we are likened to trees. That is why even life-wise, we depend on one another. We breathe out carbon dioxide. They take it in. They breathe out oxygen. We take it in. When we die, we become food for trees. Our bodies decay. They become fuel for trees. They become food for trees. The same trees then eat us to give us food. Because as they eat the nutrients of our decayed bodies, then they're able to produce fruit for our descendants or for our offsprings that are taking over from us. And the life cycle continues over and over again. Why do you think Satan wants us to rubbish fossil fuels? Fossil fuels are simply a result of our decay. A result of life that was, but now has to give back to life that is at that particular time. And the minute we divorce the fuel that comes from us, the minute we start to reject fossil fuels, is the day we start rejecting ourselves. Is the day we cut that cycle of life that God has set in motion. So we have to look at these things from all angles and understand what God set in motion, the time that he spoke life into existence of this realm called earth. There's nothing God has created that becomes useless at one point. Nothing. It's very simple. We just get stuck because we have run out of blueprints. We need to restore communication so that we know how to engage with what we have at that particular time. That we may use it in a way that it will be beneficial to us and to our generation. Anytime we start to think this is non-renewable, we cannot use this energy source anymore, there's no how we can turn it or convert it into anything useful, it simply means we've lost connection. We need to regain connection. We need to attune our divine antenna that we may know and hear from heaven what we're supposed to do at that particular time. That is why the Lord said he's calling scientists in this time. They will sit and listen to his word. These are not my words. These are the words of the Most High God. They will sit. They will be humbled by reason of the humbling of the highest in their circle in this season. As the highest in science get humbled in this season, the rest will be humble enough to come and listen to this God that they said didn't exist. They will realize and understand that science is not God. Science is the observance, the observing of that which the living God has created, the marveling of that which has been made by the Creator himself, the engaging with that which has been made by the Creator himself. There's no scientist who has made anything. There's no scientist who has created anything. They observe that which has been made by the Creator. They engage, they test, they experiment with that which God has made. And anytime they don't understand something, they come up with theories. That's why they will say theoretically speaking. Which means there's no truth to this. But because we don't know what the truth is, we are going to stick to this theory that we came up with in our imagination. And we are going to stick to that. And we are going to teach that in schools as truth. So that the following generations, the upcoming generations, engage with it as though they're engaging with truth. This is why we find ourselves where we are today. We cannot do anything without God. You cannot do. O tsana ya moga motho o bo batla go dira dilo o sa mmotse gore go irwa yang mo jarateng ya gago. O tsana hela o simolola o itirella ka ga wena o batlang ka teng without asking them. How do you run your house? How do you run your home? I would like to do 1, 2, 3, 4. Is it okay if I do it this way? Or how do you want me to engage with it? That is how we are supposed to engage with God in this planet that He has given us in this very time that we are in. Moving on. The Lord said, aluminium, very key. Very key, aluminium. Now, I believe aluminium is used... The uses of aluminium that we know of in today's time is used for window frames, it's used for kitchen utensils, for aeroplane parts, for cans. The Lord is saying that He's about to release new blueprints concerning aluminium. He said it is going to be very key in the time that we're in. So those of you that are called to the science field, pray about this. We also pray for them that they may hearken to the calling, to the beckoning of the Holy Spirit and come and sit and hear the word of the Lord, that God may give them the blueprints of what He's doing in this season that is needed and that is going to be beneficial to humanity in this time. The Lord said, aluminium, very key in this season. On the 28th of this month, the Lord said, change of course for many. Change of course for many. The Lord is saying in the time that we're in, do not be surprised as He changes the course of your life. I've said this many times that we need to pray for capacity for the kind of change, for the major changes that are coming into our lives in this very season that we are in. God says a change of course for many. And I believe that in this month that we have entered, the month of May, many of you are going to experience serious shifts in your life. You are going to see major, major changes happening and happening at very, very fast pace. I hear the Spirit of the Lord saying, at the speed of light. So it can be a bit overwhelming when change comes, but it's not even gradual. When major change comes, and it's not even gradual. It's not giving you time to digest it as it comes. But it's coming also at the speed of light. You need to be anchored in God in order to be sober and stable in your spirit, man. As everything around you is going fast, you need to ensure that your spirit is calm. That is the only way you will make informed decisions. And you will not find yourself moving according to your emotions or moving from a place of fear or moving from a place of being overwhelmed. But you will remember the word of the Lord and you will be able to be calm in the midst of the changes. The changes are meant to bring life. They are meant to bring life. They are meant to bring life. Listen, God is taking you to a place He promised. Now, majority of the time when the moving starts, when the transition starts, we cry because we don't like change. Humanity does not like change. We want certain things to happen in our lives, but we don't want the change that comes with those very prayers that we've made. As God prunes your life, it means that He may cut some people out. He may allow you to lose some people in your life while He's bringing some into your life. Sometimes it's not even people. Sometimes it's certain habits, certain things you are used to doing, and certain things that you want to save by your own effort, But God's way is the way that he wants. Certain things you are holding on to so tightly because you don't want anything to disturb that environment. But God is saying, for me to bring actual healing to that place, you need to allow me to do it my way. And my way is not your way. So you're going to have to trust me. That is all you have to do. You have to trust him in this season. You have to trust him. He says, change of course for many. Mark the word many as well. He said many. This is not a word for certain individuals here and there. This is a mass word. It's a word that covers the majority of you. The Spirit of the Lord continues. He says, ancient spirits. This part, I was seeing ancient spirits trying to emerge from the sea. Very horrific, horrific sight. I was seeing these spirits. They tried to come forth. Remember, the Lord said they wanted to bring the world, the one world order too early. And God is putting the bricks on it to say that it is not yet time for one world order. But instead, it is the time for the opposite. It's the time for kingdom come. This is our time as believers. And the Lord is saying, nothing that is not meant for this season, no matter how much the enemy may try to push for it, is going to come into fruition or is going to come or to be set in motion in this time because it is not its time. Will we see traces of what they tried to do? Yes, so that you can thank the Lord for putting the brakes on it, so that you may know for a fact, if it wasn't for the Lord, they would have succeeded in what they wanted to do. On the 29th, there's a vision that I saw. This one is going to require for us to use the board. So I believe on Thursday, that is when we're going to be touching on this one. God wants to give you an understanding of who he is and what he's doing in this time and what was and what is now. It's absolutely mind-blowing, but I need to draw it to show you. For you to understand certain things, I need to do some illustrations. So on Thursday, we're going to be touching on this one. Absolutely, absolutely mind-blowing. You need to hear it. So I'm going to skip that vision and save it for Thursday. And then the Lord has been showing me some trees, some fruit trees, and some vegetables in this time. And he's just been communicating to me about fruitfulness and what he's doing in this season. But when God shows you something, it always has more than one meaning. So for those of you that may relate with this, I saw a pawpaw tree. I know that sometimes God gives people instructions to eat certain things. And I saw it growing very, very quickly. I know it's one of those trees that grow very quickly and die very quickly as well. But I saw it growing literally before my eyes. And I remembered a word last year, beginning of last year, there were certain individuals that the Lord was telling to eat pawpaw that were trying to fall pregnant. It was a fruit that the Lord was giving. I'm not saying that that may be an instruction for you, but this is what the Lord was saying concerning this fruit, pawpaw. Those that wanted to be fruitful in this season, the fruit of the womb. I saw them being instructed to eat this fruit. So this one is for certain individuals. If your spirit resonates with it, good for you. The Lord is saying you will see that. Use that as a sign of fruitfulness in your life. Some of you, he might just show it to you at one point in a dream or in a vision to show you that he's saying very soon you are going to be fruitful in your womb. And then the Lord continued to say, calendar of events. calendar of events? Is it not my time? Why are you buying the lies of the enemy? Did I not say it is my time? Did I not say it is my time? The Lord is saying, whatever you are seeing happening in your life that may be causing you to think the enemy is at it again where you are concerned, the Lord is saying, why are you panicking? Why are you buying the lie of the enemy that keeps telling you that you are still where you were before? He still has a hold over your life like he did before. Why are you buying his lies and you are failing to believe his truth concerning you? This is a question the Lord is asking us in this time. Why are you failing to believe him when he tells you that it is indeed his time in your life? God is saying, believe me in this season. Believe what I have told you. It is time for my event to unfold in the calendar. It is time for my events to unfold in your life. So don't be buying into the lie of the enemy who wants you to believe that he still has a hold in your life. God says, I have taken over. I am in control. Don't look at what you are seeing with your natural eyes and conclude that things are still the same. God says they are not. The enemy wants you to buy that lie so that you renounce the Lord, so that you give up on what God is doing in your life, so that you start to speak and you start to declare the wrong things, because there is power in your mouth. There's power in what you say. The Lord says, do not stop confessing the right things. Do not stop confessing what I have spoken concerning you in this season, because I am doing it. And suddenly you will see it. But the enemy wants you to observe in the natural for what I am doing. Do not observe me in the natural. You will stumble. Observe me in the spirit. Observe me through my spirit of truth. Observe where you are and what I'm doing by my spirit. Because everything is taking place in the spirit realm. Only when now it is completed, that's when you will see it in the physical. So Satan wants you to believe that nothing is happening by making you observe the physical that does not reflect or show you what is truly transpiring at that time concerning your life. I want to say this to you, child of God. There's a lot. Oh, there's a lot. There's a lot God is doing behind the scenes. There's a lot God is doing with his left hand that you cannot perceive. And Satan enjoys it when you are watching from the physical realm. Because he knows there's nothing that you will see in the physical realm. During the time where Job was going through the most in his life, God was busy in the spirit realm preparing his new chapter in life. God was busy working with his left hand, that which Job could not perceive. But Satan wanted him to observe what was happening in the physical at that time. Many of you are getting weary, you are getting tired, not because God is not doing what he's supposed to be doing, not because God has failed you, but simply because you are observing the wrong place. You are observing for what he's doing from the wrong place. God says, look unto me. Look with the eyes I've given you of understanding. They are not these two eyes. You have another pair of eyes. God says, use them to see what I am doing. People who know what God is doing, they're not bothered by what they're seeing in the physical, because they know it's only a matter of time before the physical aligns perfectly with what God has been showing them in the spirit realm. Sometimes people will even ask you, are you normal? Are you not bothered that at this point in time, you are not yet established in 1, 2, 3, 4? Are you not bothered that it seemingly looks like your marriage is falling apart? Are you not bothered that it seemingly looks like you are not getting better in your physical health? Are you not bothered? Why are you not bothered? Because you know what they don't know. You know, Hazibeliana, in whom you have believed. And you know, in his timing, all things are made perfect. Not for 2 minutes, kasi magic, permanent blessings. When God showed up for Job, he showed up and showed off. No one could resist. No one could deny. This is none other than the hand of God. Even those that doubted him during his time of hardship, during his time where things had taken a different turn, they came in humility to bless Job. They blessed a blessed man. When you want to know that it is indeed your season, when you want to know that heaven has now released, the floodgates have now been opened, when you are in that season, as much as God is blessing you, even men will bless you. Even those that don't want to bless you, that normally wouldn't bless you, will bless you. They won't even say, but this man is getting blessed, it's too much. They will bring. Why? Because it is him. When the blessing comes, it causes even men to bless you. Because it is the law of blessing. There's that which comes from above, and there's that which has to come from the earth itself. When it's your time, beloveds, you won't even have to force anything with anyone. At the end of the day, even your enemies are in the hands of God. God causes things to work out according to his counsel, according to his spoken word. And God is saying in this season, trust him. When he says it is his time, he means it is his time. And you are about to see the goodness of the Lord in your life. But he says, hold on to truth. Hold on to my ways. Do not get tired of doing good. Do not get tired of being who I've called you to be. Do not get tired of doing what I've called you to do. Because in due time, I, the Lord, will bring you into that place of blessedness that no man can resist and no man can deny that it is indeed him. The Lord continues to say, Cancer, Tropic of Cancer. The Tropic of Cancer is located north of the equator. That is in the north hemisphere, the northern hemisphere. And I remember the word that the Lord gave concerning the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere, to say that whatever that is going to be taking place on planet Earth in this time, the northern hemisphere will be hit the most. He said the northern hemisphere will be hit the most. Like I said, on Thursday, we're going to be doing an illustration so that you may better understand some of the things that God has been communicating concerning what is about to be happening on the global scale or on the global platform. So I believe that we're also going to be touching on this part. So pray for Tropic of Cancer, that area. Pray for that area as well, because it looks like concerning the word for northern hemisphere, Tropic of Cancer is, God is like, it's like God is zooming in more and more into places that are going to be hit the most by what is going to be taking place on a global scale. Apparently, it passes through Mexico, the Bahamas, Egypt, Saudi Arabia, India, and southern China. And when I look at all of this, I remember the word God gave concerning Saudi Arabia, that we were going to be seeing brimstones coming to certain areas in Saudi Arabia as a sign of judgment over certain things and certain places that are a direct insult to the living God. God will say he's going to be sending a very strong message to Saudi Arabia by reason of brimstones that were going to be going to certain areas, like directed missiles to certain areas in Saudi Arabia. So I'm not surprised that it is within the region of the Tropic of Cancer. So we need to pray for these areas. We need to pray for the people living in these areas, so that when the angels of the Lord come to scan for the righteous ones that can be salvaged, to scan and to look for the remnant, that many may be found within that group. Many may be saved from what is coming in these areas. So that's that concerning that word. And then the word of the Lord continues. He said, Malesu, Malesu, Duma, Duma, Duma. He just mentioned these names. He didn't say anything. Those of you that have gone through the prophetic word of the Lord in the past, where he gave judgment concerning this nation, where he spoke about the political space and what he has planned for this country, you know exactly what the Lord has said concerning some of these individuals. You can go back to that word to find out what the Lord said. And I just want to say, let's keep them in our prayers. Let's keep them in our prayers, because like I've said, to God we are all his children. God is not fighting flesh and blood, but he is fighting the enemy that uses flesh and blood so that the flesh can be saved. The flesh can be saved. So God is looking to save individuals. So even when we see certain things happening to certain individuals, which don't have to happen if they are to repent before it hits them in the physical realm, because we serve a merciful God. When we turn away from whatever it is that God is not pleased with in our lives, God is merciful. When we come in true repentance, God is merciful, because none is perfect. All of us have fallen short of the glory of the Lord, except for the Son of God. But when we come in repentance, God forgives and God makes a way for us. The word of the Lord continues. He says, sorghum, sorghum. Remember the last time he said maize. Now he's saying sorghum. So for those of you that God has been talking to concerning sorghum, he says now is the right time to engage in that. The Lord said irrigation the other day. He wants us to learn ways of engaging in farming in all seasons throughout the year, so that we may be able to become self-sufficient where food is concerned as a nation. The word of the Lord continues, and he says, Lot, 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 tell them I am coming for the lots. Lot, 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 come out, come out, come out of Gomorrah, come out, come out. The times that we are in, beloved, are very, very serious times. Very, very serious times. This word, I'm going to save it for tomorrow. It's a very important word, and I feel that it deserves the fullness of attention for me to elaborate on this word and to give you instructions that I was hearing from the Lord concerning this word. He says, Lot, bo lot te bana ko irile mogo yon. Modimar, it's time to come out. It's time to come out of Gomorrah. It's time to come out of Gomorrah. We'll get to that word tomorrow at 7 p.m. during our Monday service. The word of the Lord continues. He says, Harry, Harry, stop. So I believe this has to do with Prince Harry. The Lord says, stop. I don't know what he's up to. I don't know what's happening. Also, there's a word concerning these individuals on the 31st of 2021, when we are coming into the new year. God gave a very lengthy word concerning the royals in England. And I believe that some of you know what the Lord said concerning Prince Harry. But the Lord is saying he needs to stop. I don't know what he is doing at this point in time that is displeasing before the Lord. And then he continues to say, new management, Barcelona, new management, new management. I really don't know much about football. I don't watch football. I don't know what is wrong with the current management. But the Lord is saying new management is coming to Barcelona. So for those of you that may know more about football and what's happening there, but this was not the first time the Lord was giving a word concerning Barcelona. They retrieved a word from February this year where the Lord said, Barcelona, seasons are changing. Seasons are changing. You can see that it is very consistent with the one that he gave this week. It's very, very consistent. He said, Barcelona, seasons are changing. Seasons are changing. And then he, on the 8th of December last year, he said, Barcelona, many will ask, where has your talent gone? I will shift it. On the 29th of this month, the Lord said, patience. He continues to echo patience. And then he said, vision. All men speak. They receive vision now. My vision. Fire. Fully recovered. God is saying he is recovering your vision in this season. He is recovering your vision. You will see everything that the Lord is saying concerning your life in this season. He says your vision is being recovered. The scales are coming off of your eyes. And you will start to see what the Lord is saying about your life. And he says it is nothing new. It is nothing new. He has communicated it to you before. But the enemy came and caused confusion. And you didn't know what to believe anymore. You didn't know what was true and what wasn't true anymore. But God is saying he's bringing stability back in your life. He's bringing clarity back in your life. So receive that clarity in the name of Jesus Christ. Receive vision. In the name of Jesus Christ, may your vision be restored in this season, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. I do away with all manner of confusion that the enemy had planted in you in this very time. I decree and I declare that you are coming back to your senses in Christ Jesus, in the name of Jesus Christ. I decree and I declare that Holy Spirit is your only counsel. In the name above all names, the name of Jesus Christ, receive it for yourself. The Lord said, you are fully recovered in this season. So receive full recovery in this season. In all areas, may God recover you. Where you were scattered, may God recover you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Where there was confusion, where there was loss, may God recover you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Where you have been hemorrhaging, may God recover you in the name of Jesus. May you no longer lose any blood in the mighty name of Jesus. If you have gotten into any covenants that have resulted in your blood being taken in the spirit realm, that have resulted in you opening a window for the enemy in your life, in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, may you come out of those covenants in this very day that give the enemy license, legal right to your blood, legal right to your pockets, legal right to your children, legal right to your identity, legal right to your destiny. May those doors be closed in this day. May those doors be closed as you renounce him in this very day, as you pray a prayer of renouncing the devil, renouncing any covenant you have made with him, knowingly or unknowingly, come out of it in the name of Jesus. You need to understand something, beloved. Everything works by legalities. So sometimes Satan tricks you into giving him legal access into your life legal access into your finances, legal access into your children's lives, legal access into your marriage, legal access into your business. And God is saying, come out. Sometimes you come into it by reason of dithuso. That is something that is very, very common, that majority of you fall into that trap. Majority of you fell into that trap that very day. May God remind you of that day today, where you gave Satan access, where you gave him legal access into your life. Whether it happened when you were a child, in your adulthood. Holy Spirit will remind you right now. Whatever it is, if it's still in your house today, get rid of it. Get rid of it. In this season, God wants to simplify things for you. Not to say that there's anything wrong with other things that God may use in our lives. But anytime God is doing a cleansing, the confusion, he doesn't want to bring confusion. He will put the brakes on a lot of things that we can even use in the church to make sure that you are able to be cleansed fully. In this season, God is simplifying things because he's recalibrating us. He's rebooting our belief system. He's rebooting our lives. He's redirecting us on the path of righteousness that we may be able to access our inheritance. That Satan may no longer have his hand in the jar of our inheritance. It's time to cut him off, beloved. It's time to divorce the enemy and align yourself with Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. And God says, in this season, as you do that, full recovery comes in your life. Ska hella modimo pelo o simola o mopataganya modimo ga patagangwe le sepe ga patagangwe. He is all capable, all by himself, all by himself. He does not need help. Jesus doesn't need help. The fullness of everything that you need is in him. Why? Because you were made from him. Everything about you comes from him. There is nothing that needs to be added to that which he does. Nothing. He says benevolent. Benevolent. This means charitable or gracious. We're in a season of giving. I've said this before. The Lord says, we're in a season of giving. Be compassionate. When God moves you to give, give in this season. These are seeds. There are certain seasons that are very potent. There are certain seasons like this one where the enemy is ushering in famine. God is ushering in abundance. And that abundance is unlocked by giving. And giving as per instructed by the Spirit of Truth. By the Spirit of Truth, and he will register in your heart and in your spirit, man, how to give and where to give. He says, this means charitable, gracious. You can look for other synonyms that have to do with this word, benevolent. And then he goes on to say, money, new man, increase, evident increase on every side, evident increase. Are you ready, my children? Are you ready? Evidence. The Lord is saying in this season, he's bringing finances into the kingdom of light. He's bringing finances into the kingdom of light. And if you noticed, Harudimu, this word goes hand in hand with the word I've given before, where the Lord says, not everything I'm bringing into your life belongs to you. I have called you forth because you are the stewards that I have chosen in this hour for fair distribution of wealth. Why is God removing the leaders that he's removing? Because they are not doing a fair distribution of what they've been entrusted with. Some people are hungry while some are going to bed feeling like they will vomit because they had more than enough. They ate some of the food they ate did not belong to them. Can you be trusted with the resources of God? Can you be trusted? Do you know and understand that not everything that is handed to you, not everything that comes into your life, not all that comes into your life belongs to you? You are a mere steward. There's a reward for you in and within that which you have been given, but it doesn't all belong to you. So God is saying, pray to him for instructions. Pray to him to understand your assignment in this season. Remember, he said you are essentials in this season. You are going to be needed. You are meant to feed in this season. You are called to mother. You are called to father many in this season. You are called to bring life where there was no life. You are called to help in situations where there is no hope. Because a lot is about to take place in this world, and God wants to come through for his people. And he wants to use you to come through for his people. Uska inyata. You shouldn't. You know why? Because it's not about you. God just wants vessels. It's about him. He has the resources. He has everything that is needed for this hour. He's just looking for barongwana. Obata go roma. Ka o rongwa ga o simolo wa ra hore hey nna ke sena morena ke a go ba thusa kae e ga o nang, but he does. He has more than enough for you and for everyone he is marked to help through you. More than enough. So God is looking for your yes and your amen and your loyalty and your faithfulness to every instruction he's going to be giving you on a fair distribution of what he's going to be handing to you in this season. And believe me, when you serve God faithfully, he will not withhold anything good from your life. Everything that you want, everything you need, God will provide for it according to his calendar. He will provide for it because he is a God of more than enough. So you shouldn't worry, hey, hake banela na ke sala kaeng, hey, morana na ke are ke are. The more you prove yourself faithful, the more he will bless you and entrust you even with more than you could have ever imagined. The Lord continues to say, Kulitana, come. And then on the 30th, which is yesterday, he said, money. He continues to say, money cometh. And then he said, believe. Just believe. I know it's difficult, but the Lord said, just believe. We're in that season. That is why God is very strict in making us understand who he is and what these blessings or what these finances that are coming are for. That is why he's very much stressing that point of stewardship, that we may not get it twisted and we may not get drunk in the money that is coming in and forget the God that gave the money and what his plans are for that money. He said, little ones, do not move. Do what I have called you to do. Wait upon the Lord. Wait. Suddenly I do it. At thy word, pull increase, empowerment. Change is here. Change is here. La utahor moranari. Are change is here. Change is here. God is looking for stewards. That is all he's looking for in this season. God is looking for stewards. God is looking for those he can trust. Those he can entrust with his resources. That he may do what only he can do in this season. I remember a word he gave in 2020 where he said, my people shall eat and be satisfied. And he said, I will do for my people what the government has failed to do for my people. I will do for my people what the government has failed to do for my people. I keep hearing him say, some of you, he is going to instruct you gore le tsenye ditsela ko magaeng a lona. What do you do when God gives you such an instruction? Some of you modimo wa go instructa are epam didiba tse gwang go nwa the fullness of the community. Everyone will be allowed to drink from didiba tse wa go diphunya. Phunya tsa batho ba medidiba. Modimo o bata serious people in this season. God is not playing games. There was a time he showed me the budget that has been allocated for this time to the group of people that he's calling forth to use in this time. And he said, don't even ask me how. Just believe. Just believe. But I want to do major things through your life. Major things. Ha ke gore a ke re agela so and so a house. And don't even put it up on social media. Don't do any of those things. Just do it silently and I will bless you. I, the Lord, will reward you for what you've done. Or I want you to open a school or a place of recreation for the kids in such and such a place. I want you to take care of the people of this particular village. Monthly buy them food. God can entrust 400 people, 1,000 people to you. And you are not the one who's going to be feeding them. He is the one who's going to be feeding them. I want you to go to your village. Teach them how to do irrigation farming. Empower them so that they may be food in this place. The soil is fertile. The people are illiterate. They don't know how to farm in this kind of environment. Phunya didibe batho ba simolole go lema. Go nne le dijo mo gae. These are the kind of individuals God is calling forth in this season. Some of you, God will bring you, will call you to bring about light, power to certain villages. There are some villages that we don't even know exist in this country. There are some villages that are not even accounted for in this nation. But people live in those villages. There are no health facilities. There are no schools. There is no form of civilization. There is no electricity. There are no reliable sources of water supply. God says millions are coming. O ole le ka pele ka di million go bona gore a nne go tlaati. Ha bona re nya me go ha motho teng ha re ka dira sengwe go ka gogo madi a ga mo a tlhogong ga itebala. Then God brings more. Let's see what you can do with billions. Some of you are going to end up with trillions. I know I may be sounding crazy right now. Some of you be like, kante mosadi wa modimo tsetse o nole ga ke a nwa sepe. I've spent time with Jesus. That's all I've done. I've spent time with the Lord. You see, when you deal with this God, he's a God of balance. He doesn't get you to be someone who's fixated on money, on stuff. He gets you off stuff because he wants to give you stuff, but he doesn't want the stuff to have you. He doesn't want the stuff to have your heart so that you can engage with stuff as exactly that, just stuff that we use as humanity, so that you can be able to distribute stuff without holding on to it with your heart. That way you can be a usable instrument in the hands of God to bring about change. Those are the individuals that God is looking for. Isingwa le bayana a isinga gago o busimola wa planelo he kana go moke mathe he motho ka dira yana a dira jana. But you've been given strict instructions on what that money is for. But when it's just figures to you, figures that can bring change over there, they're supposed to bring change over there, they're supposed to do this over there, and then for me personally, it's just this and this and that, but the rest is not mine. Those are the individuals that God is looking for. We cannot finish God. God doesn't use money. He doesn't need money. He owns everything. He doesn't need money. So anytime he withholds, it's because you are still not at a place where you understand your assignment. and you are going to misuse what you're going to be given. But once you know what you're supposed to do, release comes. God brings it into your life, and there's no corruption. There are no unfair dealings. You haven't bribed anyone. It's purely God. Why? But because now you understand. These are the type of leaders that God is scouting for in this season. Some of them you may not necessarily like their character as individuals. But when it comes to the assignment, they are excellent. And that is what God is looking for. That is why with certain individuals like Donald J. Trump, many don't like him because of how he talks. He's a very brutal man and he's very blunt. He's very blunt. So because he fails to choose which words he uses when and how, you know, some people may have a problem with the way that he talks. But our problem is that then we like to listen to the serpent. Why? Because the serpent is charming. The serpent knows how to put words together. The serpent knows how to tell you what you want to hear. Isn't that what politics is all about? They sell you a dream that you are never going to see. And once you have said yes, and once you have put them where you what they want you to put them, then the serpent shows you its true colors. But with certain individuals, what you see is what you get. So the same way they're blunt about everything they're saying, everything they're promising you is exactly what they're going to do. Why? Because they stand by their word. They stand by their word. So anyone that God tells you, I've chosen this person, I've chosen that person, don't doubt God. Don't doubt God's chosen ones. Even when you are one of them, don't doubt yourself. Because God knows things about you that you don't know about you. God has seen the end from the beginning. He knows when you are in this type of situation, you will do it. When he puts certain things into your care, you will get the job done. He knows you. Don't even allow the enemy to make you disqualify yourself from what God has called you to do. Don't do that. You don't know this God, but you are about to get to know him. You will get to know him. That's how you will know that it is him. You see, every single one of you in this season, you will not deny that it was God. Even the people that know you will say, this is God. That is what will be taking place in this season. I don't even know if we have time to get into the message concerning marriage. It is 9 o'clock. It's already 2 hours has already clocked in. So, I've taken too much of your time. So, do you want a little bit, just an introduction of what that message looks like so that you can go and ponder on it? If you give me that permission, I can add an extra 15 minutes to give you an introduction to what the Lord is saying concerning this message. It's a very, very sensitive one, I know. It's very touchy. Okay, some of you are saying continue. So I'm just going to give you just an introduction of what the Lord is going to be helping us to understand concerning this issue, marriage. All right. Majority of you are saying continue. So there's a scripture that the Lord gave me that I found so intriguing concerning this topic. In John chapter 4, the Lord kept saying, the Samaritan woman, the Samaritan. So in John chapter 4, we see Jesus Christ waiting by the well of Jacob for a certain woman from Samaria who he knew was going to be coming around that time to come and draw water. So this is what the scripture has to say. I'm going to start from verse 5. It says, so he came to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near the plot of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there. Jesus, therefore, being wearied from his journey, sat thus by the well. It was about the sixth hour. A woman of Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, give me a drink. For his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. Then the woman said to him, how is it that you, being a Jew, ask a drink from me, a Samaritan woman? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans. Jesus answered and said to her, if you knew the gift of God and who it is who says to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. Then the woman said to him, sir, you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where then do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well and drank from it himself, as well as his sons and his livestock? Jesus answered and said to her, whoever drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I shall give him will never thirst. But the water that I shall give him will become in him a fountain of water springing up into everlasting life. Then the woman said to him, sir, give me this water that I may not thirst, nor come here to draw. Jesus said to her, go call your husband and come here. Then the woman answered and said, I have no husband. Jesus said to her, you have spoken well. I have no husband, for you have had five husbands, and the one whom you have is not your husband. The one whom you have now is not your husband. In that you spoke truly. The woman said to him, sir, I perceive that you are a prophet. And then she goes on. And then at the very end, it says, this woman went back after she was so amazed by what Jesus said. She went back to the village and then she told the people who she had come across, and even told them. The Bible says in 25, then the woman said to him, I know that the Messiah is coming. 28, it says, then the woman left her water pot, went her way into the city and said to the man, come see the man who told me all things that I ever did. Could this be the Christ? Then they went out of the city and came to him. You know, when I read the scripture, there's something that happens in my spirit that just bubbles up with excitement of the truth that God continues to reveal about himself and us and everything concerning the engagements and the relations of this world, especially this one sensitive one called marriage. The Lord spoke to me concerning thirst. Have you ever wondered why? For those of you that are married, before you got married, you felt you needed to get married. There's an emptiness you felt that you knew has to be filled up by something. And we know that from all the relations that we have as humanity, the ones that we uphold the most is marriage and children, is family. And yet, time in and time out, we have seen over and over again that this thirst that we have, for some odd reason, no one is able to quench it. Some of you, you are married to the love of your life, but you are still cheating on them. You are still looking to other men or to other women to quench that thirst. Some of you, there is nothing wrong even with your sexual life with your spouse. They do everything according to the way that you want. They satisfy you, or they're supposed to satisfy you. But for some odd reason, you are still not satisfied. Some of you, this thirst comes in the form of affection. No matter what your husband does, it never seems to be enough. Monna Modimo o setse a tsere loan after loan after loan. Now you are in serious debt because he wants to quench that thirst in you. But it is not getting quenched. Have you ever wondered why? Some of you try to quench that thirst with children. Some of you, you might be struggling to have children and you think that thirst is going to be quenched by children. So you have resorted to having children outside wedlock, outside your marriage or your marital home, because you want to quench that thirst. Today, I want us to talk about this thirst. What is it? What is it exactly that we are looking for that we cannot seem to find in our partners? Some of you, you are married to everything that you wanted in your list. That is the only reason. Because you were not forced to marry whoever you married. You were not forced to marry that person. You married them because at that time you were convinced that this is the person that I should be spending the rest of my life with. What changed along the way? What made you believe otherwise along the way? What did you find out? Some of you feel like you were sold a lie because what you had in mind is not what you are seeing with your eyes. And your spouse, on the other hand, is feeling the same thing, that what they had in mind is not what they are seeing with their eyes. And that is why they go outside to look for that thirst to be quenched. The search doesn't stop. You are now in a covenant, but you are still searching. You are still searching. What are you looking for? Have you ever stopped to wonder? What are you looking for? You are now sleeping with the 500th person in your life. You are still searching. What are you looking for? As a woman, you are dumping now. What are you looking for? Every night you go out, you have to find somebody else to sleep with other than your spouse. What are you looking for? Have you ever wondered? Have you ever stopped to wonder? When we put away the rubbish that we have learned as tradition, as wisdom of our cultures, or whatever we say in our cultures, if these things were true, wouldn't women be happy and satisfied with having their spouse being with other people? If this was the natural way that God wanted, if we were meant to speak to men anyhow with how we treat them, if that's how it's supposed to be, what are we looking for outside? What are we searching for that we still are not able to find? You are 65 years old. You are still looking to younger ladies to quench that thirst. But those other ones that used to be young and now are old did not quench it. But you are still not learning and understanding that that is not what is going to quench your thirst. If you read this scripture, the Lord Jesus Christ talks about thirst. He talks about water. And then when this woman asks him to give her that water, he changes the subject to say, "Where's your husband?" You see, if you know how Jesus operates, every time he sparks up a certain conversation that is meant to bring divine revelation on certain matters, he will start with the revelation before he comes down to what is happening on ground. He says, "Are you not tired, woman, of doing the same thing over and over again? Have you not stopped for a minute to ask yourself, there must be something beyond this. There must be another explanation for why I'm on my sixth marriage. And this one is not even a marriage. But it is not working. Why is it that all my relationships are failing? What am I looking for? Is it something that I can really find in a human being? Can it be something I can really find in a human being? I've tried with this first human being. I didn't find it. And I thought to myself, you know what? Maybe there's something wrong with him. Maybe it's because of the fact that he's broke. Maybe it's because he is skinny. Or maybe it's because he is fat. Or maybe it's because I don't like his family. Or maybe it's because of this or that. Let me look for this one. This one has certain things that this one didn't have. But you are still thirsty. You are still thirsty. You start to think to yourself, maybe it's because he doesn't buy me roses. Maybe it's because he doesn't appreciate me the way I see my Lebogo's husband appreciating her. Maybe I should look to another one to quench this thirst. Could it be? What is this thirst? I'm not satisfied with the sex. I'm not satisfied with the way he dresses. The way he talks, I don't like it. When I met her, she used to be, you know, this kind of shape. And now, so let me look for another one that matches the kind of, the ideal look that I think will quench this thirst. And you go on to the fifth one. The Lord says, have you ever wondered, could there be more that you are looking for that cannot be found in your spouse or any other person? Could it be that humanity as it is, that men and women as you see them, flesh as you see it, cannot satisfy that thirst? Omogo wa bo 5 wa bo 6 siame la go te batho bana le seemo wena ko wena o siame. Don't you think it's about time you stopped and wondered, Lord, what is it? Is my spouse perfect? No. Am I perfect? No. Are there certain things about my spouse that I want changed? Yes. Are there certain things about me that my spouse wants changed? Yes. Are there certain issues that I feel like are just too much for me in my marriage that I don't know how to handle? Yes. What is it that we are looking for? And then I'm going to get to another question. We'll come back to it. What exactly do we look for when we look for partners, marital partners? What exactly are we looking for? Many of you have different things that you look for in a partner. I want someone who doesn't cheat. I want someone who wants to settle down. I want someone who values family. I want someone who has the same values as I do. I want someone who enjoys the kind of life that I enjoy. I want someone where we share the same interests. Those are all nice, cute, beautiful things. And there's nothing wrong with that. But is that enough? No. Does that qualify us to then come into a marital covenant? No. What then qualifies us? The question becomes, apart from everything that you lack or love about one another, or that you have in common with one another in the physical, the number one question becomes, are you divinely compatible with your spouse? Are you divinely compatible with the person that you are knitting yourself with and becoming one with? Have you actually become one? Have you actually knitted together and have seen yourselves as one, inseparable? Are you divinely knitted? Are you divinely orchestrated? Has your marriage been divinely orchestrated by the living God? Am I saying that we are all supposed to hear from God audibly to say, this is your spouse? No. No. The same way that God speaks to you about certain issues and you know that this is God, and you go through with it because you know that it is God, it is the same way God can show you or give you a nudging to say that this is your life partner. Sometimes you can't even explain it to people. You just say, I just knew that this is her, or I just knew that this is him. There's a confirmation that is coming from the depth of my spirit that this is my partner. I'm not talking about butterflies, because butterflies come and go. I'm talking about an inner knowing that comes from your core. Now, we're going to go a little bit deeper. What then do you do when you know that this is my spouse that I was given or that I was shown by God? But once you come into that marriage, you find out that there are still some things about them that you may not necessarily like, that you are only getting to find out about once you are in the marriage. What do you do when you know that God has showed you that indeed this is your husband, that indeed this is your wife, but when you get into that marriage, you realize that they're still struggling with porn? What do you do? What do you do if you realize once you are in the marriage that this person is still struggling with cheating? What do you do? What do you do when you get into that marriage and you realize that your husband or your wife is still struggling with abuse? What do you do? But you know that you know that you know that you know that God showed you that that is your spouse. What do you do? Jose Monate, Jose Bonolo, Hotelele. But you know, when you look back, you know that, but God showed me that this is my husband, this is my wife. But in reality, it is not adding up. In the beginning, you saw a glimpse of who they truly are. But then that glimpse went away as if it was all a lie. And suddenly you are introduced to somebody else that you don't know. What do you do? This is a very, 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 very sensitive matter. And the reason why God wants me to speak on it is because we have two extremes that are taking place in the time that we're in. Two extremes that God wants to deal with. Oftentimes when we find ourselves in relationships or in a marriage that doesn't reflect God, the first thing we do is we don't go back to the drawing board where God is concerned and ask him what he has to say. We don't go back to the drawing board to ask God, what do you have to say about this, Lord? What do you have to say about this? Am I in the right place? If I'm in the right place, what is your strategy for my marriage? What is your strategy for my marriage? I'm going to say something that may sound a little bit insensitive, but I want you to listen to the very end and hear me well. Some of you are in relationships where you are being abused. Some of you, it is very, very serious abuse. Very, very serious abuse. Physical abuse, verbal abuse, emotional abuse, mental anguish. You are in seriously abusive relationships. Some of you, you are being cheated daylight. We tsela gore wa ba le go go semamma we itse le mme wa teng gore ke mang kana re wa teng gore ke mang. As you are sleeping alone in the night time, you know very well gore o go semamma. What do you do? But you know that this is the man or the woman that I believe God gave me. But what is this that I'm seeing? And what is the one thing that we resort to? My biggest worry is that we have come to a time and we have come into a dispensation where we don't really engage God as God. We don't engage God in the fullness of who he is and the image of who he is. We engage God according to the level of understanding we can take and according to the temperature of our emotions and what we believe our emotions can take and what they cannot take. Or when we are people that truly want to follow God, we follow him blindly and allow ourselves to be in very dangerous situations because we want to do the right thing, but we lack the knowledge on how to do it God's way. That will glorify him and that will also show the world and distinguish God from the rest by reason of the wisdom that you are displaying through your life, and that which you are going through in your life gets to be a testimony and a lesson for many to know the ways of God. We know very well in the world when you are in an abusive relationship, we don't even want to know anything beyond that. Get out. Finish. It's that simple. Get out. It's that simple. And then you get into another relationship, he abuses you as well. We tell you, get out. It's that simple. You get into another one, he abuses you more than that one. Get out. It's that simple. You get into another one, same thing. Now, umo wabu drink. Get out. It's the same thing. My question then to you is, when are we going to wake up to the true power we have been given and who we truly are? When are we going to look for answers and solutions to our everyday problems from the one that we claim to believe in? The one that truly carries answers, which is Christ. The Lord took me back to the cross. He took me back to us and him because he is the foundation of all things. And when it comes to marriage, marriage is the one thing that reflects, and there's the one thing that God has esteemed above all other ways that he has related with humanity. When he got ready to reward his son for following through in his assignment, as much as he's the King of Kings, he's the Lord of Lords, he owns all things, he is all things, and everything that was made not outside him, but of him, he gave him a bride. He gave him a bride. He promised him a helper, a wife. And who is that wife? The one he died for. And what is her condition right now? If I may ask you. The one that the Father gave him. Remember that the Father only gives the best gifts. Some of you are saying there's no sound. Can you hear me? This is a very important part. Can you hear me? Am I audible to the rest of you? Am I audible? Can somebody indicate if I'm audible? All right. I pray that audio will be restored back to you, whoever you are, that you cannot see, you cannot be, you cannot hear us. So when the Father got ready to give his son the reward, the best gift he could give him, what did he give him? He gave him a wife. He said, of all that I can give you, of all that I can give you as the best gift I can give you as my son, I'm going to give you this woman called the church. This is the reward I'm giving you. This is the woman that I'm giving you. This is the perfect help for your mission. This is the perfect helper of who you are and the vision I've given you. This is who you are going on a mission with. This is the one I have knitted you with as one. This wife called the church. That is the one I'm giving you. And I'm not going to change my mind. Why? Because my word is sure. I don't change my mind with the gifts that I give you. With that which I have entrusted to you, I don't change my mind because I know what I'm doing. When I give you what I give you, I know why I'm giving it to you. When I say that it is perfect, I know that it is perfect. I don't look at how it looks now. I look at the end from the beginning. I don't look at what is happening in between. And I'm going to be giving you strategies on how to get her to look like what I have shown you in the end. Spotless. White as her garment will be as white as snow. You are pure. You are everything good. You are righteous. And I'm giving you a wife, a helper that is compatible to that which I've called you to be. But I want to ask you, the wife of Christ, today. And I'm talking about the fullness of who you are. Can you say that you are ready? You are a spotless bride that the Father showed the Son when he gave him the wife, when he gave him the helper? Can you say that you are spotless? Can you say that you are exactly what he has called you to be? Can you say that you match the purity of Christ? Can you say that you match the righteousness of Christ? And if you don't, let's look at the wife today. Let's look at the wife today. The Bible tells us, and we know for a fact, that until the church has been perfected, and until everyone, because in Ephesians we get to understand that majority of the body of Christ is still scattered. And I've made a statement to say some of them are still drug dealers, some of them are still prostitutes, some of them are still murderers, some of them are robbers, some of them are all sorts of things. But the Father has already concluded that that is the bride of Christ. But she's still being perfected into that which the Father has shown the Son concerning the wife. And then the Father says, I give her to you. This is the one I'm giving to you. And I want you to wash her with the washing of the word. I'm going to be perfecting her until she becomes what I've seen the Father show me. And how am I going to do that? The way that the Father has shown me on how to perfect her. And what did Christ do? He went on the cross. And when he was on that cross, he was dying for a wife that was rejecting him at that time. He was dying for a wife that was spitting on his face at that time. He was dying for a wife that was killing him at that time. He was dying for a wife that was acting like anything else other than a loving wife. Other than an honorable wife, a respectful wife. My question to you today, my friend, as you have come into Christ and said you are going to reflect him, and said you are going to allow Christ to continue to be Christ through you. For those of you that know for a fact that God has shown you your spouse to be the very person that he has called you to be in partnership with, to be in marital partnership with. Where do you get the audacity to give up on that person? Where do you get the audacity to say you are tired and you are giving up on that person? When you yourself, as the bride of Christ, on a daily basis, you go before him crying to him, to be a husband to you, to be a God to you, to be loving to you, to be forgiving to you, to be patient with you as you are being perfected, and asking him to help you according to the instructions and the strategies the Father has given concerning you, to be faithful to those instructions. Like I've said at the very beginning of this, we have two extremes. We have people that are in abusive relationships where they'll be told, just stay. God hates divorce, just stay. Khontse hela yalo, a go keteka malatsi othe, o sa itse ratse tseno tlo go bola kana ha ka ka go bola, and they will just tell you, just stay. And you have another bunch that will tell you, just leave, find another one. The same demon that was in that one is going to enter the other new one. And then he beats you up and then they tell you, leave. You go to another one, leave. You go to another one. What are you looking for? You are looking for refreshment. You are looking to be quenched. You are looking for rest. You are looking for satisfaction, contentment, peace, joy. And the Lord said, the most important question in this matter is it the person that I have given you? Is it I that put you in that marriage? Is it I that put you in that relation? Is it my will? If it is my will, in this very day, I want you to look to me on how I'm going to restore that marriage. Why? Because if it is God that brings you into that dysfunctional relationship, into that messy relationship, that means that God wants to show himself to that person. That means that the Messiah wants to manifest himself through you to showcase his love and mercy to someone that is in bondage by the enemy. It is, isn't it amazing how we are so quick to say that we are not fighting flesh and blood every time when the enemy is using us. But if the enemy is using another person, it is not the enemy, it is that person who has chosen to live like that. It is that person who has chosen to be exactly that. Isn't it amazing how we are so quick to be impatient with others? But where we are concerned, we are expecting Christ to show up merciful. We are expecting Christ to show up in a way that is compassionate, that is understanding of the dysfunction in our lives. We want them to know and understand our background, the traumas we went through, the life that we had before we met them. But where they are concerned, like I said, these are sensitive issues, but these are things that have been experienced in the Bible. When you read the story of Hosea, it's a very painful story, but in the end, Hosea gets to see. He gets to know the God he heard about but didn't know through his experience. He got to know the God that he didn't know through his patience, through his obedience to God in a painful situation. Hosea was given an instruction by God to get married to a harlot. By God. God. And at that time, the very things Hosea was preaching against were the very things he was experiencing at home. What do you do when it is God that puts you in that situation? What do you do when God gets you married to someone with a very unfavorable past? And that person is still attracted to that unfavorable lifestyle. But God tells you, I want to show myself God. I want to show up as Jesus through you. I want to take my wife back through you. What do you do? The problem is we have esteemed our emotions beyond the will of God. We have esteemed our emotions beyond the will of God. We have esteemed happiness beyond the will of God. We have esteemed our timetable on how we want our lives to be, when we want it to be, like what we have expected, against the will of God. Jesus said he's come to die for all. He's come for murderers, for cheaters, for prostitutes, for drug dealers, for all of these people, for gamblers. He's come for all of them. And how is he going to show? When he went back, when he ascended, he gave the mission to us. He says, now I multiply myself. Now I multiply myself by giving my spirit that is come to witness of who I am. How do you witness of who Jesus Christ is? By dying to you, by dying to your desires, by dying to your ambition, by dying to the picture that you had for your marriage, for the kind of marriage you want. When you said yes to Jesus, you said, I'm willing for you to manifest and show yourself God through me to someone that needs to see you, to someone that needs to know you, to someone that doesn't know anything else other than the way of life that is sinful, to someone that doesn't know anything other than the ways of this world. I'm willing to allow you, I'm willing to allow the fruit of the Spirit to be perfected in my life through this marriage. I'm willing to allow the fruit of patience, of long suffering, to be perfected through me. Am I saying stay where you are being beaten? No. God can instruct you to go to a certain place and be separated from your spouse for some time, while God gives you instructions that will help in the overcoming of the lifestyle of your spouse or in the deliverance of your spouse. If you are willing for God to use you to show up in the life of your spouse, is it not painful? It is painful. There's no pain like the pain of a loved one. Now you get to understand when the Bible says he intercedes for us weeping, interceding for his wife. Because he's not going to give up on his wife. Jesus is never going to give up on us. That is what makes us even love him the more. That is what causes us to repentance. The fact that in all seasons, even when we are unfaithful to him as his wife, he remains faithful to us. He doesn't change who he is. The other question he brought to me is, do we really know and understand the sacred, how sacred it is, the vows that we give, how sacred they are? Do we understand what we are saying when we say it? Do we understand what it means when we say for better or for worse? Do we understand? Do we understand what it means when it says in riches and in poverty? In health, in sickness? Do we understand? You say that, but there are certain things that once you are in it, you will say, but this one. But that's not what you said. That's not what you said. You said for better or for worse. But when worse comes, you want out. Yet you want Christ to be faithful to his covenant and his vow to you. In all your dysfunction, you want him to understand that you are a work in progress. In all your dysfunction, you want him to understand that you are being perfected. You want him to forgive you. You want him to continue to pray for you to get better. Remember what he said. He's coming back for a spotless bride. Some of you need to be separated and allow God to work on your marriage and bring you back once he has perfected things. Majority of you, God is not calling you to divorce. He knew that once you came into that marriage, all hell would break loose. Why? Because Satan has now come out to play. Whatever spirit that has been working and operating in your partner has now come out to play. God showed you who your partner truly is. But now something else has taken over your partner to show you what the problem is where he's concerned or where she's concerned. And God says, now I want to be God through you. I want to be Jesus through you to now take in and wash this part of my wife, because that is part of Jesus' overall wife. He says, now, by the way, kiss. So now this is the mission. You remain in your function as a wife or as a husband. And I'm going to be giving you strategies on how I'm going to come through you and show myself as God and faithful and a savior, because I'm here to save. That is the fundamental thing that Jesus Christ has us in this place to do. Why do we find it easy to save other people that are outside? Why do we find it easy for us to want to see people saved that are not kin to us? But when it comes to the very people that God has put in our lives, we easily give up on them. And yet those are the very projects that God has given us to perfect even our own walk with him. To perfect his character in us. Through the very challenges we see ourselves going through in our relationships, in our marriages. God is trying to work on you, but you are busy taking the very thing he has brought into your life to perfect you. You see it as the problem. Because as you allow him to work through you to deliver and to save your spouse and ultimately his wife, he's also working on you as his wife. He's working on your patience to be patient as he is, to be long-suffering as he is, to be forgiving as he is, to be holy as he is, to be righteous as he is, to be all things that he is. Remember in the beginning we said the Father has given him a suitor that is suited for him, compatible with him, because they are one. But right about now, are you one with Christ? Are you as patient as he is? Are you as selfless as he is? Are you as passionate for saving others as he is? Are you willing to die to yourself and your pride as he is? And say, Lord, I lay it all down for you. How do you want to use me to save my husband? How do you want to use me to save my wife? How do you want to reveal yourself through me, Lord, to this lost man, to this lost woman, to this man that has been captured by the enemy, to this woman that has been captured by the enemy? The enemy has come and he's using them. Lord, how do you want to use me to save them? Give me your wisdom, Lord, that even as I'm willing to do it, I may not do it in foolishness, but I may adopt your teachings, your wisdom on how to do it. What do you do when you are dealing with someone who is very dangerous, someone who is very violent, whom the enemy is using through violence? You need God's wisdom. You need God's ways. Some of these things, God will use you at a distance and entrust you to remain faithful. Can you remain faithful to your spouse even when they are not around you? Even when you know that they are not being faithful to you at that particular time? Jesus Christ is not looking for another suitor as he's waiting for us in heaven. He's not. He's sorted. He knows he's sorted. But his wife is busy being unfaithful on earth. His wife is busy doing all sorts of things. All sorts of things. His wife. He's the King of Kings. He can have anything he wants. But the Father has given her, has given him you. With all your dysfunctions, with all your shortcomings, he has given him you. How dare we think that we deserve something perfected when we ourselves are not perfected yet? How dare we become impatient with others that are still captured by the enemy when we ourselves expect Christ to be patient with us? Which Christ do we believe in? The church has lost power. The church has lost the ways of God. The church now looks to the world for advice. The church now looks to the world that is powerless for the ways of the world. And we are getting powerless counsel from a powerless world because now we are powerless ourselves. Why? Because we are not submitted to the Spirit of God. We are selfish. We want to think about our own. Satan already introduced it to something called happiness. Happiness. Let me show you what the Lord said concerning this happiness thing. That there are some things he said I found very interesting. He said, thirst is quenched by knowledge and revelation of one's identity. If you recall what I just read for you concerning the Samaritan woman, when she said, Lord, give me this water that you speak of, where I'll never thirst again. Jesus had in mind her lifestyle. He wasn't even talking about water as in the water that we drink. She was thinking from a shallow perspective, but God had searched deeper into her soul and was seeing what was the true root of her problems. What she needed to be quenched from was far more deeper than what she was thinking where water was concerned. The Lord says, thirst is quenched by knowledge and revelation of one's true identity. When Jesus Christ told that woman her life's journey, she was shocked. That was the shifting part of that conversation. What are we normally looking for that we are not able to find in our partners? That we then try to find in other people. We try to quench through sex. We try to quench through money. We try to quench through clothes. We try to quench through stuff. We try to quench with all sorts of material things. What is it we are looking for? You move on from this person to that one, to that one, to that one, but none of them is quenching that thirst. You are looking for someone that can define you. You are looking for your identity. You are looking for someone who knows you without you having to explain yourself. Why? Because you don't know you. You don't know you. So you are looking for someone who can give you identity. Someone who can mirror you. Someone who can show you who you are without you having to explain yourself. You are looking for your true identity that you lost in the Garden of Eden. That is what you are looking for. And God is saying, it cannot be found in your spouse. It cannot be found in your small house. It cannot be found in that prostitute. It cannot be found in the money. Because some of you are not even cheated on with a human being. Your spouse is always working. Your spouse never has enough. They are always trying to accumulate more and more and more for the family. What are they looking for? Identity. Identity. And only Christ can give you that. We are asking for too much from one another. We are asking for too much. It was editor that no human being can give you. Listen. Even beauty doesn't quench it. But the other piece, they struck you. You're like, my God, I can just be looking at you all day. Your eyes, when I look high, man. The butterflies are done. The beauty is still there. The butterflies are done. It's a lie. It's a lie. You got the man with the money. You are driving the car. You are living in the house. You are still not satisfied. It's a lie. But they are not the problem. They've done their part. They are being the best that they can be in that relationship. But they cannot be God. You are looking for your spouse to be Christ. They are not Christ. They cannot be God. Allow God to be God in your life. And allow humans to do their part that can only be done by humans. Jesus said, I am the one that can quench your thirst. Lesa go tshentsha banna. Kgwedi le kgwedi o tshentsha monna. Ngwaga le ngwaga o monneng o mošwa. O mosading o mošwa. Oba sadi sadi. Ga o ise o lemogeng gore ga gona sepe mo dintsetsong tse o di lekatse. O nwetse ruri bojalwa. You are deteriorating quickly. You are aging quickly because you are always moving from person to person. You don't know what they carry. You don't know what spirit is operating in them. Spirit is a kid, say, I have given you the anointing and the grace to overcome it. Because wa sile ya no o ile go bata mathata mang o ntse wa thataganya mo botshelong jwa gago wa thataganya because as you sleep with all those other people you are taking their burdens in as well, you are adding to that which you are supposed to be tackling at home. What is the problem? Thirst. You can ask them, those that chased even after money, to say that now you have this and this and this. My brother, my sister, are you happy? If they don't have God, if they're honest with you, they will tell you, I am not. You are married to the most beautiful woman. You are married to the most handsome man, and he has the money. He has this. You guys are comfortable. You don't even have to have too much. You just have to be comfortable. Are you happy? Are you joyous? I don't even want to use the word happiness. Are you joyful? Do you have peace? You are looking at the wrong source. And so you are blaming the wrong person for your dysfunction. You are blaming the wrong person for your dysfunction. As they are cheating on you, are you doing your part? Why are you looking to someone's lane? Because that's another thing you need to understand, beloved. Khale kopantswe ke Modimo. Khale kopantswe ke Modimo. Ke ra le kopantse Modimo. A le kopantswe ke Modimo ga isa re mathata a le hatsa, gaana go la apara. Khale kopantswe ke. Mathata a rona ke go akanya gore ka gore ha re kopantswe ke Modimo gore re go a go nna perfect. Ke hallelujah, hallelujah, hela witso ke ha. We are in heaven already, you are not, you are on earth. You are wrapped by other things around you. You both come from different backgrounds. You don't know what your spouse has been through that they're still battling with. You come with your own ideologies about how you want marriage to be, and then when the picture is not that, you want out. Where is the Christ in you in that? He says, the peace that surpasses all understanding. Why does it surpass all understanding? Because under normal circumstances, you shouldn't be having peace, but you have it. Why? Because you are operating from above. You are operating by the Spirit of the living God. That is the Spirit you are operating by. He says, as you become one in your marriage, you have two lanes nonetheless. As a wife, you are called to be a helper. You are called to respect your husband. As a husband, you are called to love your wife. Now, whatever they are doing at the time, that is none of your business. You are called to respect. You are called to honor. If they are hitting you, go home. Pray for your husband and honor them according to the way God wants you to honor them. That doesn't endanger your life. And wait on the wisdom of the Lord and the power of God to move on your behalf, to win your wife or your husband from the grips of Satan. I want you to go and ponder on these things. And if you have any questions concerning this topic, because I know, like I said, it's a very sensitive one. And I believe that your question will be very much relatable to many other people. I will trust in the same spirit that has been giving me wisdom concerning this to continue to give me more wisdom concerning the matter. Kubusiho, I want to release you. So I'm going to stop here. I believe I've done justice to the introduction of this topic. God wants to restore marriages in this season. God wants to restore us in this season because marriage is also the foundation of your assignment as one. And Satan wants nothing else but to ruin that covenant, that marriage. That's why when he came in the garden and he manipulated Eve, and then he stepped aside and caused them to blame one another. Satan went after he caused the discourse where Mela had, and then you start pointing fingers at one another. Satan is the one that is causing everything in your marriage, but he wants you to see your spouse as the problem and not him. That is why the Bible says we fight not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers in high places. Your spouse is not your enemy. That is where I will end today, and I pray that God will give you wisdom and understanding on the matter. And I pray that God will also help you in this time to gain strategies from Him on how to fight the good fight where your marriage is concerned. And know that He is faithful and true, and nothing is impossible with God. God bless you, and have a wonderful, wonderful weekend and the rest of your holiday. I will see you tomorrow by the grace of God at 7 p.m. A very important and a timely message we are going to be touching on concerning the prophetic update that the Lord gave us, where many of you are going to be affected by what is about to transpire in the time that we are in. I hope that you are blessed, and I hope that you learned something from today's word. God bless and keep you.